Pardon me?
He was asking about number three, he didn't want us to go down.
Okay.
He's done.
Yeah. Have you started recording?
We have, yes.
Oh, I should start recording too. I'm supposed to generate some sort of tone when I start recording so that Nina can sing, so let's go.
No, we can sing it, we should do it twice.
Okay. Right. Okay, so I'm going to be talking basically about the GE object system. There is nobody who now doesn't know me over here, so I'm going to skip over introducing myself. But yes, so what is GE object? Right, so we're just talking about this. So GIMP is the new image manipulation project, and that's like the de facto open source Photoshop. And while writing the GIMP, people realized they needed a UI toolkit, which is GTK, the GIMP toolkit, which then became the UI toolkit for the entire desktop environment. And all of this development was happening around like 97, 98. As this stuff was being developed, so the context for the entire thing is we were living in a primarily C world. There were other languages, but it's not what you would typically use to write sort of the underpinnings of your system. You wouldn't necessarily write stuff in Perl to for your Pinder toolkit and stuff like that. And there was C++, but the C++ story, I think the open source C++ story back in those days was quite terrible. We had like forks of GCC just to enable better C++ support, and it wasn't very clear. So at the time, the folks who were working on this stuff decided that they would like to use C to build out all of this stuff. And if you ever work with a UI toolkit, like the concepts based on which you build UI toolkits lend themselves very well to object-oriented programming. So you start with everything is a widget, and so everything needs to be able to show itself. And then some widgets are clickable, so those kinds of widgets have sort of like a click method, and from that you can have a button or a text box or whatever. And it's kind of silly to build a UI toolkit and not use object-oriented methods. So at that point, it became necessary to have an object system in C, right? And that's effectively what GObject is. GObject is an object system written in C. It's part of a larger library called glib, which provides sort of a bunch of foundation functionality that you normally get from sort of the base libraries in any language other than C. Stuff to deal with networks, to deal with files, and threads, and all sorts of things that aren't part of the standard C library, or weren't at least at that point. And so I won't be talking about glib or GIO that much. It's mostly GObject that I'm focusing on.
Yes, also cross platform. So it, like, it has apples for cross platform.
Yeah. So what is it that we're looking for when we're talking about GObject and object system in C? So the basic thing that you want is you want to have objects, you want to be able to inherit new types from those types. We would prefer not to do standard C-style memory management where you have to remember where you are locked in, where you need to free stuff. So reference count your objects, whenever I want to take reference count the object, I increase the ref count. If I want to be done with it, I decrease it. At some point, ref count goes to zero, which means nobody cares about this object, and it goes away, and all the memory management that is associated with it gets taken care of. Properties and signals, I'll talk about these a little bit more a little later, but effectively we wanted public API on these objects to deal with sort of public data members, as it were, and as well as ways for the objects to send notifications and to sort of receive events as well. We want bindings, like just because we're writing the base layer in C doesn't mean that all our applications should have to be written in C. That would be quite terrible. So we want easy language bindings, so that we're writing stuff in Python, JavaScript, Perl, whatever, Rust. It needs to be easy to be able to write with the construct of that language and still be able to use glib-based space that we can deliver without too much of a hassle. And as Nivek was saying, one of the goals is to be portable. With geoptic itself, portability is not that hard to take care of because, I mean, the type system is fairly platform agnostic, but GLib as a whole is quite portable. So threading, network, IO, all of this stuff is written in a way that works on Windows, Mac, Linux, various Unix variants and stuff like that. So that's one of the goals as well. So just to show you what this looks like, so we use this extensively in GStreamer, right? So you at the top level, you have a geoobject from which you derive a type called G-initially unknown, from which we derive a GST object, and then you have elements which are the building block things. Bins are collections of elements, and a pipeline is a special kind of thing. Right. So, I was talking about UI toolkits, but mostly my examples will come from the GStreamer side because I'm more familiar with that and you know better examples there. But this is kind of effectively the kind of hierarchy you want to be able to build. We also have over here properties, for example. Right? So, we have properties where you have an associated type, the property has a name, and it's read write. So, this is basically a data member on a GST pipeline object that is exposed. With this name, with this type, and has a default value, things like that. We'll dig in a bit further with all this stuff shortly. Right. Before we start, I wasn't sure what the demographic of the audience would be, so I didn't know how much code to throw in. Right? So I kind of guessed what would make sense. If stuff doesn't make sense, like let me know. Like I can either zoom out more or zoom in more, depending on kind of what people feel like. Right. So yeah, so let's start. What we want to do is, I'm going to start with how would you define your own type in GObject, and then we'll try to break that down into how it actually works. Right. So this is an actual object that we have in GStreamer. It's a audio ring buffer object. It represents an element that has an audio ring buffer, which is just a little buffer, throw an audio sample, throws in a loop. Now, if I want to define a custom audio ring buffer type, what I need to define two things. One is this is the instance structure. So any audio ring buffer object will have this structure, and you need to also define the class, right? And this is something you typically don't have to do in other languages. You're not writing the class structure yourself. So in C++, it's basically all hidden behind the scenes for you. In Ruby, I guess you can get a handle on the class and like play around with it, but here you actually have to write the class yourself to start with. Right? We fill in these structures as we go along. But yes, so first you define the instance structure and the class structure. Okay? And then this is a little macro that we provide to make things very easy. You say, I want to define a type. This is how I would write it in camel case. This is how I would write it in the other case. yes. And this is the parent type. Okay. This is a macro and which basically expands to the type of the parent from which I want to derive this type. Okay. Once I use this, this is basically using a bunch of stuff, a bunch of functions of under the hood, but it's very repetitive and there's a lot of code involved. So what we do is we have some conventions that we follow. So typically, GST is, for example, the library prefix, and then you have the object is an audio ring buffer, and so we like camel case that appropriately and have an equivalent underscore type syntax for the lowercase function. So this is for the data member, data structure, and this is for the function. And we need to provide effectively three functions now. We need to provide a class in it, which takes the class structure and fills up whatever we need. So there may be function pointers or classified data members, they need to be initialized. That happens in a class init function. You have an init function which is for instance initiation. So every time you create a GST audio ring buffer object, there are data members in there and maybe whatever else is there, you want to initialize that. For every time you create a new object, this will get called. Right? And when you want to get rid of the object, they are finalized methodology part. And you remember there was a GST type element before, right? That was the type. How this works is we actually have a get type function that you're supposed to, that gets created by the gdefine type macro, right? What that basically does is it gives you, it registers the type with the type system and gives you a handle to the type, okay? And it, just to kind of, this makes things look like, okay, you've got a type handle over here, that you don't have to care that's a function under there. So this kind of the convention we follow, which is the library prefix type and then the object name, okay? So how would you use this? You basically do the G object name, give it the type. These are some additional instantiation parameters that you don't strictly need, right? But this is effectively, okay? So, does this make sense? Any questions? Okay, so just to summarize, what we did here is we created a new object and said we want a new object of this type. This type is comes from this, which it actually registers the type itself with the type system. The type system registration happened with this bit of magic here. This created this getType function using all these things, right? And so, voila, that's how we got here, our input object.
What is the null
for? You can give additional construct type parameters if needed, but by default, if you don't give it, you just use the default values.
You need to dominate the list with
null.
That's the
null. Right. So you can, so this is basically you can give name value, name value, name value for construction parameters. Okay? And if you don't have, and the last one has to be null. So, but this is not there. Right. So let's just dig in a bit deeper into with what we did there. Right. What the gdefine type was doing is actually creating, like using this method that gdef gives you, to register your type with the type system. Okay? So what we're saying is, we're telling the type system, this is the parent type. I want to call the type, give it this string name. I'm going to give you some information about how to create and destroy that type, and some flags, like is it an abstract type or not, and things like that. Now, what is the information we give it? Basically, we need to say, this is the size of my class structure, and this is how you initialize and destroy it. And this is the size of my instance structure, and this is how we initialize and destroy it, right? So effectively, why you need that is, if you look at this, what gobject new is actually doing is, when you call this get type, it goes and says register this type. And after registering the type, it says, how do you register the type? How do I say, give me this type? It effectively create a new class structure, you know the size, so I just create some memory of the appropriate size, and then I say, I have an instance. I have a initialization function, so I give the initialization function this pointer and say initialize it, and now I have a class. The same thing applies for the instance initialization as well. How do I create a new instance? I say I need a structure of a given size, and I initialize and deinitialize. So what this looks like is this. Okay. Yeah.
You need to worry about this. This is just to explain how it works.
Yeah. So gdefine type generated this for you. Right? You don't have to write all this stuff unless you really need to customize how your type is being built. Right? So the get type function, so this was the code of what we saw before, right? The gdefine is the static. This is the parent type. This is the name. And this is the information I need. And this information, most of it is like effectively not needed. What I do need is, what is the size of the class, so I can create a class pointer for the appropriate of the appropriate size. This is the initialization function, right? And by default, I don't even need to free anything because this thing, it's just get rid of the memory. I don't need a deep free. So this will get called with a chunk of memory of this size, and that's how you get a class object. Same thing happens for the instances as well. So this is the size of the instance. And this is the function you call with a pointer to some memory area of that size to get back an initialized instance of this type, right? And this basically, this gtype register static effectively goes to the type system, which has like effectively a table saying this is the type and these are the IDs. So it basically creates a new type ID, puts it in its hash table with this information, right? And it now knows that this type exists. And yeah, so the get type function, the first time you run it, right, this thing will be zero, so this entire bit of chunk of code will get run. But subsequently, you just return just the type.
Okay.
So, yes. Which is also why we kind of use this. We want to hide away the fact that it's a method that happens just once. Yeah.
Hybrid, but this is the first time you've seen this. I've never figured out how this stuff works.
Right.
So, you don't have to understand this perfectly.
So, did you show the actual structs for the class and the problem?
Oh no, not yet. So the struct, this so far this is what we have. Okay. We don't really have to care very much.
But the struct has to be written by us, right?
Yes. So we have to fill in the struct.
Yeah.
And I'll talk a bit about how we fill in the struct. Right? But for the most part it's a normal structure. Right? There's only a small thing that changes to make sure that the inheritance works correctly. Yeah.
Which macro generates all that?
This one.
Right.
So the gdefine type actually creates this get type function, right? And declares these so that you just have to actually define the function for class in it and in it. Not even finalized really, but that you could define. Right. So that's effectively how you register with the type system. And so part of why this is so I didn't really have to care about much of this stuff until I was sitting in a debugger and looking at random memory and I didn't know like what's happening. And then I started looking at these nests of macros and trying to figure out what's happening. And it was really interesting to me because normally like you're doing C++ or like Ruby code or whatever, there's like all these things are just hidden away from you, right? So this is just like it's possibly somewhat disturbing that I find this exciting and like so we can like poke at all the internals like from the debugger, but it's also fun to kind of see how it's not like rocket science. It's fairly straightforward, and if you started implementing a type system, this is probably all stuff you do anyway, and this is probably all stuff that's happening underneath under the hood for whatever language you're using as well anyway. Right. So now. Is it clear how everything actually, when you create the first object, all your initialization actually happens at that point? Does that make sense?
And to make sure that for all of the parent types as well.
Right. Yeah, so we'll get to that. But effectively, what happened is, GeoMemo, you call that macro, the macro called get type actually caused the type registration to happen the first time, right? And the type registration, if you see, during the type registration, I call this macro, which actually will now call GST element get type, right? Which will have GST element's version of this, right? And so it changes up all the way. Right? So the first time I call this, right? This is a macro. This macro expands to GST audio ring buffer get type. GST audio ring buffer get type is this function. Right? The first time it's called, the type is zero. Right? So this thing gets called. Right? Now this G type register static gets called with this. Right? And GST type element is again a macro which expands to GST element get type. So the parent class will get initialized in this process and that'll chain up all of it. Right? So you don't need any special library.
You have like a slide with those constructors, right? There must be some code that spits out those constructors like that.
No, it's because it's just the how you construct it is up to you. What happens is when so for example over here, when GST audio ring buffer gets in it gets called, what's happened is your G object new this took the this size took the size of the info, basically the malloc and got a piece of memory of that size.
Okay.
And then called this function with a pointer to that memory. Right? So you have to write the init function. So now you have basically zero initialized structure. right? It'll be a JSC audio ring buffer structure. And you need to now initialize it because only you know how to do that.
Okay.
Right.
So if you can go back to a couple of slides, I was talking about this code.
Right. So this is the code that you need to write now. So these are the three functions. They're declared by the macro and you need to write them.
Sure.
Actually, you don't need to write handlers, you kind of need to repair between these two. And you fill them in saying, okay, for example, if the GST audio ring buffer structure had some pointer that we need to allocate, right? You do this in this function, and so on and so on. Or like it has some whatever data fields that need to be called.
It's a name. Like you tell a field in the structure called name.
Yeah.
You initialize it.
Like you create the name and so on and so forth.
But you need to ensure that the name of this thing is the same snake case thing as you give the macro.
Yes. Yes. So that's a matter of convention basically. So yes.
Why would you pass an object to the init function?
Pardon?
Why are you passing an object to the init function?
So I got a zero initialized object,
okay.
Like a zero bit of memory, which is the structure.
Okay.
I now need to initialize the data with meaningful values.
Oh, okay.
Right?
Yeah.
That's like how Python passes the first parameter as the self.
So this is the self of the init.
Okay.
Right. Right. You don't have a base to
right.
get
yeah.
a handle on.
Yeah.
That.
Yeah.
This is how you do like the dot notation in Ruby.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right.
Right. Okay, good. So that is basically creating an object, right? Now let's go deeper into the type system a little bit. At the core of the entire type system, you have these two things. You have a G-type instance and a G-type class. Everything is derived from this. Okay? And this is the actual definition of a G-type. A G-type is just an integer. Okay? So your get type function returns a G-type. That's just an integer, like an integer ID. That's generated by the type system dynamically. Right. So what do these have? The type instance only has a pointer to the corresponding type class, right? And the type class just has a type. That's it. This is again the actual definition. This is all there is to it. This is at the bottom of your inheritance chain of whatever types you inherit from in your type instance, right? So now I want to create a type called my child. Okay. So this is how you do it. So going back to, for example, the GST audio ring buffer, that was derived from the element type. So what you'd embed here would be a GST element, right? So the parent type is embedded in as the first member of the structure. Same for the class. Okay. And this is exactly how inheritance is implemented in C. Right? So if I have a grandchild class, I embed my child as the parent and my child class as the parent class. Okay? What that means is, so in object-oriented programs, my child is a G-type instance because it's derived from this. And like just embedding this thing at the top has effectively inherited from that, and my grandchild is a my child. Okay. The reason this works is that in C, you are guaranteed that no additional padding will be added at the beginning of the structure. Right. So if you take some memory that is a my grandchild, okay, and typecast it as a my child, it will work. Like it will work as expected. There's no unexpected memory in between. The first. So if the size of my child is n, and the size of my grandchild is n, the first m bytes of n are identical to my child. Like it's exactly my child, it's exactly the same layout. Okay, so this works. So I have a method called my child goes to school.
Is this a spec?
Yes.
Spec?
I believe it is a spec.
Okay. So the thing, ECC does not allow this. Unless you pass aliasing allows, the C standard does not technically allow this, but compiler has been allowing for so long that everything depends on it and you can't break it.
Right.
It's a compiler.
It's
not in the spec.
Interesting. Okay. So
it's implemented defined in the spec.
Okay.
It's implemented defined in the spec.
Okay.
And you can't change it because everybody uses it.
That is interesting. Okay. Cool. Alright, so apparently it is part of the spec, but just convention from the early 80s.
What are you using as a flag?
But I would like to actually confirm that, because it does work. I'm pretty sure you don't need
You don't need to force a flag. But they will want it by default, it's on. You can disable it.
Mm-hmm.
And then it'll be around for these things.
Interesting. Okay, cool. Okay, so yes. Right, so you have my child goes to school, which takes a my child pointer, right? And say in this function, you create a my child type. By the way, this, I forgot to update this code, but you never do g type with create instance. You should use gobject new, and you should derive everything from gobject. The g type create, the g type instance is meant for creating fundamental types in the gobject library. Everything else should be derived from gobject itself. But that's okay. So I create a type of my grandchild, and I just typecast it as a my child, and pass it to this function, and this will work, right? And I'm able to use my grandchild as a my child. If you're ever writing code, you'll typically see you'll find yourself writing a define like this, which is my child of O, which takes any my child or subclass instance. And actually does, this is another macro which does a runtime type check to make sure that what you pass is actually the type you expect, right? So over here, instead of doing this, you would do this, right? And the advantage is you get a runtime check to see that the type you're passing it is actually the type you expect, right? And you can disable this, you can build glib to not enable this if you want to save on performance. Though I don't think it actually has a big performance impact.
What does it actually check? I mean, you're just getting a bunch of
memory. What you're getting is something that is derived from a G-type instance. So from the G-type instance, I can get the type class. And in the type class, I have the...
Yeah, I'm saying that you introduce some bunch of memory, assuming it looks like this.
Right. So for it to pass this check, right? The size of the bytes of the class structure have to be, like, first the instance has to point to the correct class, and the class has to have that ID, right? So yeah, this is just convenient stuff that is typically done to make sure that you can do type checking on things that you want to, right? So that's basically it. So now that you can just embed a structure in another structure, you can inherit, like, data numbers are inherited effectively, right? So if my child had an integer A, that's part of my grandchild as well, because it is embedded in the entire structure at the beginning. But you won't want to do functions like that. You don't want to copy all the function pointers like that. So this is typically how you would do it, right? So you have my child class, which has that's wrong. This is wrong. This should be type class. And you have a pointer, say go to school, right? For that takes a my child, right? And my grandchild class is derived from this. So this also has a copy of this pointer. Now what we would do is you've got the my child implementation of go to school, okay, assume it's defined, and in the class in it, you effectively say, class go to school is my child go to school. So that's the function pointer to use for the go to school method. Right? Typically, what you would do is, in the go to school implementation, you'll get the class, right, and say use that go to school. So what this is doing, right, is getting the class of this child. Okay, of this child instance, it's getting the corresponding class, a copy of the class.
I mean, this code is like pretty much boilerplate, right? You would have the same code for all sort of code,
right? Right. Yes, you would. But it's not boilerplate in the sense that it depends on what your implementation is, right? Like, you might want to get the parent class and, like, call the appropriate method. So typically what actually happens is, we keep a handle to the parent class, available as like a global. So that you don't have to do this. So when you do gdefine type, it actually creates a global variable like a static, so it's global only in the file context. It gives a handle to the parent class. Okay, so you can just directly access parent class, go to school, right? But I mean, I didn't want to add that bit of complexity there. Pardon me?
So you can choose to not call the function there, right?
You can
choose, like the my child class function, you can choose to not call.
You can choose to call a parent class function. Right?
Yes, you can. You can actually say, go to the parent.
Is it essentially like if you don't want to override the function like the child? That
yeah, then you just leave it.
Okay.
Right? If you want to override, then you would do, oops. Yeah, then you do something like this.
So basically the delegation of function is handled by each like yourself.
Yeah.
The system does not do it for you.
How do you mean? You mean like chain like
not
the,
chain like if it were Java it would just call the,
right?
the thing at the last
the last overridden thing in the hierarchy. That's what happened by default. So if I don't do this, right? So what happened? Okay, so how this happens is, let's just go back a second. You have my grandchild class. What happens if when you instantiate the class object, when you're registering with the type system, it creates a my grandchild class, right? And it calls the my child class in it on this part. So the initialization is chained up all the way. Okay. What that means is, by default, if the my child class in it set this pointer, and my grandchild class in it didn't set this pointer, then the previously initialized one stays there. Right. So by default, like you'll get the default data, you can override it in a subclass. Right. And you can always get a handle to the parent class and even chain up.
So no, I'm not talking about that one. I'm talking about the my child go to school thing.
Huh, this one.
Yeah, so what's that portion for?
This is basically okay, so from an API perspective, you won't tell your API users to find the parent class and call this method on it. Right? You can provide something like this, which effectively calls the go to school method.
But sure, I understand right now.
Right now, so effectively, this is okay. So from when you're giving up API, right? You're not actually going to these like the my child structure and the my child class structure are opaque. Usually, you don't want to give them access to that. So when you write the API itself, so if I want to give a goes to school API, I'll write this function and export this. Right? I'll export this, and this internally will look up the class and call the function pointer, right?
Is that how you?
Yeah, because I don't want to expose like my data structure, right? The structures are okay.
No, no, it makes sense.
Yeah. Cool. Right. So yeah. So effectively, your type system has a copy of each class structure, right? It's like through the whole hierarchy. So you have my grandchild class with the overridden go to school. You also have a copy of my child class with the original go to school. So in my grandchild's this implementation, I can say look up the parent class, give me that function pointer, and call that as it. So you can chain up if you want. I mean, it's effectively you'll have another G type instance get plus
get
function.
Base class.
So yes, so that's what I meant. Like you actually have a handle on the parent class, like that's just automatically generated for you for convenience by the gdefine type method. So you don't have to do this jumping through hoops for it.
Super
and super methods.
Yeah. Right. So, because that was dense enough already, I didn't want to add how we do interfaces. But it's fairly simple. So when you define the type, an interface is just a set of function pointers. Like, so that an interface, so for example, if my child goes to school, so if you have a child interface, which is like...
It's also a struct.
Huh.
It's a struct which is
just a set of function pointers. Right? So you just, when you register the type, you can say this type also, like the gdefine type has an extended version which says implement interface, and you give a pointer to a structure with those function pointers. Right? And like, so you can just say these are the interfaces I implement and these are the function pointers with the implementation of the interface.
And you just create the appropriate function.
No, yeah, you write the appropriate function.
Yeah, you write a function pointer to create the definitions for you. So to define that.
The type should be there, but no, more importantly.
Enum and all that.
What happens in enums,
right? The C had enums?
Yes.
Okay.
C had enums, you had enums. So, but we even do types for enums, like we have an enum type in glib, so you can register, these are my valid enum values, and like you can have convenience names and stuff like that.
Can we also define methods on those values?
Like what? Methods in what sense?
I think Java allows us to have methods on enums.
I'm not sure about that. How does that work?
Okay, so you are talking about enums as like constants, right?
Enums is constants. Yeah.
Can you have like multiple inheritances?
No, you can't. So that's the drawback of it, right? Because how we're doing inheritance is we're effectively saying embed the structure at the top.
Yeah.
And that becomes your thing. So I can just typecast it.
Okay.
But I can't do that with two parents.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
So I can't do multiple inheritance like that. Like not C++ style, like derived from A and derived from B.
Which is such a shame because it's such a beautiful.
So if you need my
pretty nice. Yeah, so you'd have to do it. You'd have to do it via interfaces.
Okay.
So, yeah. So the nice part about doing interfaces as part of the type system is also that it's again registered. So you can actually say this object provides this interface, and then at runtime you can check does the object I have provide this interface? Then I'll use this, else I might have a fallback method, right? Which we do, for example, for objects that provide a volume interface, right? So you can say this thing provides a volume interface, so just use it to apply a volume. Otherwise you say, okay, this thing doesn't have a volume interface, I then need to do volumes myself. Things like that. So yeah, so the advantage of doing interfaces like this is that you can have behavior on runtime based on these things. Or if you expect an object with a particular interface and it doesn't have it, then you can error out and things like that. Right. So that's kind of the hard part of GeoMap, right? Like, once you build the type system, like the other stuff is actually relatively easy. Like so the inheritance part and like making sure that types actually work the way you would expect from like a language natively having things, that's the hard part. Everything else is quite easy. So GObject is the first thing that's, I mean, it's basically just derived from a GType instance, right? It's an object that gives you a bunch of things, the first of thing of which is a ref count, right? So you create GObject with GObject new, right? And when you want to take a reference, you do a GObject ref. When you're done with it, you do a GObject unref. Of course, these are atomic, so it's thread safe and all that. When the ref count reaches zero, what ends up happening? So the GObject class has a dispose method and a finalize method, right? So when the ref count reaches zero, it first calls dispose and then calls finalize. Why we have two steps is basically a detail that is not terribly important, but it's for if you have cyclical links between objects, the dispose part is supposed to drop all references, and then the finalize is supposed to free the memory. So typically, you won't have to deal with heavy situations with them, you can just implement a finalize method. And yeah, so so if you're deriving from anything that derives from GObject, you will have to override the finalize method in your class name, right? And what that also means is in your finalize method, you'll actually have to chain up to the parent finalize. Okay.
What were the ref and unref methods you showed in last? Yeah,
That's for, so since the geoobject is a ref mounted object, you basically, when you do a geoobject new, you get an object with ref mount equals 1.
Yeah.
Right? And then, so you can just pass it around. If something needs to take a reference, it takes a reference, and when it's done with that reference, it unrefs it. Right? So when all your refs are.
No, I don't understand that. Taking a reference, what does that mean?
So it basically means that this particular API is going to take this object and needs to keep it. It's ownership basically.
That makes sense.
Right.
So this is like the consumers of that object,
yeah,
incrementing the comments.
Yeah, so for example, if I have an API that takes this object and keeps it around and needs it to not go away, right? Maybe I take this object, keep it in the list for consumption later. I will take a reference and make it so that, so I'll say, do a geodic new, say give it to something that holds on to the object. And in my function, I'm done with it, I do a geodic unref. So unless the method I call that needs to keep a copy has taken the reference, it's going to go away from under it. So that needs to take a reference.
It's literally just a ref count inside the object that you can use it over
there. And what cleans it up in the end?
So when the ref count, you provided a finalized method.
Oh, okay.
So when the ref count becomes 0, it's called the finalized method.
It doesn't call
the unref calls the finalized method.
Oh, the unref calls it, okay.
Yeah.
Is it?
Right. So that's ref counts, okay. Properties are effectively, again, what like we saw, this is data members. In class, and if you say, my all instances provide these properties, you just register properties. It's really very boilerplate code, but I'll just show you some stuff anyway.
Somebody must have built a GC for this.
Probably.
GC for what?
You don't have free
manual ref counting.
I don't think there's any DC for illegal VM for that.
So every time you create an object,
you
have to
running that.
Yeah,
basically looks at DC.
But that would still be slow on the ref count because we have to keep track of each.
Yeah,
and it would be like, it would lock on,
but it probably won't
serialize
perfection, right? Given that, like, if you're not doing ref counting.
So maybe the ref counting is faster than this GC, because you have to have GC after the
sure, but it's more effective than that, like, maybe you don't get all the ref counting, maybe you don't unref at the end of the function.
Why not? You know,
that's not what you're supposed to be doing when you're writing these.
Yes,
if
you
have
to free. And if you make it, you're breaking your
yes.
Then, I mean, if you find it needing to do double correcting, it could probably implement it on all of this. But usually, the lack of predictability and stuff. Okay, so double correction makes sense if you're not manually tracking that count. One. Or sometimes when you want to, like, not, for example, collect three overhead and dump it at one point. And usually the high overhead part is allocation rather than freeing. Because sometimes if you run out of your, like, your heap is not large enough, you're actually then going to the kernel and doing an SBRT, getting more memory and stuff like that. So that's usually the unreadable part in allocation. What happened?
I think one problem is that when you call unref, I think you check for the reference count.
Yeah.
It's very unpredictable. You don't know whether it's calling
finders
or not.
Right.
That can affect.
That, yeah. So in some sense, you're saying you'll trade off like unref predictability for, like, to say if you have a smart way of knowing, okay, now I'm not in the middle of something busy, then I can call my finders. But that's what I'm saying. The finders is usually not a heavy process. Like, even if you're doing like 3-3-3, that's just like counting. It's effectively going back into whatever bucket that you allocated. Right, that's usually a very light operation.
C is usually very fast.
If you have your own memory management, then it's a light operation. But if it's going to...
No, even C, like the standard C library free is usually very, at least on Linux, it's fairly low overhead. The part that might be high overhead is actually allocation. Because if you run out of, so you've got a bunch of virtual memory, but not all of the, like, the RAM pages aren't allocated to you. Right? So once you run out of RAM pages, right? Like the next time you do an alloc, right? That's actually going to memory and saying, hey, I need actual physical RAM to back this virtual memory that you promised me. And that can be a longer process.
When you malloc, when you use malloc, it doesn't actually give you guaranteed memory. Only when you actually write that memory, then check whether the memory exists, and then it gets out. That's why, that's how the, at least in Linux, that's how it works.
Yeah, it depends.
Yes.
Right. So this is how you do properties. It's really not just to see where we are. We are in like one of the elements class in it. Okay. You can. It's actually derived from like a whole bunch of classes. So there's like base sync, and then the base audio sync, and then the audio sync, and then this call sync. And base sync is an element. So you'll see that like there are lots of behaviors that we override with in here. So to create a property, basically you give it an ID that prop server is from an enum, and you basically say the parameter is, this is a short name, long name, short name, like capitalized name, description, what default value to give it, and whether you can read, write, etc. Right? So this one, for example, is readable only and not writable. So, and then effectively, so these are introspectable now. So I can actually see like server, device, parent device, and they have the corresponding type. And I have all my parent classes properties too. So the first one I defined was server, but the parent properties had parent classes I defined a bunch of properties. So I have all of those. The idea is effectively.
So you can, you don't have to declare the properties in struct beforehand?
I mean, how you deal with, that's a good point. How you deal with them is up to you, but effectively, the properties are implemented by GObject. So what you'll notice is these two lines. Right? So I need to implement the getProperty and setProperty method. Right? So I'll get this. This will get called when something tries to query a property on this object.
So the properties are dynamic. They're not pre-known.
They're known at class in time. Okay. So I know the set of properties, right? And when I create the class itself, I know what properties I support, and I register it. And I say to set properties, call this function, and to get properties, call this function. And this function is effectively just a switch. Right, it gets the object, what the property was, and a sort of box value. Okay, and then I just say okay.
No, I mean you don't have to define this in the struct.
It is defined. That's up to me. I will probably have a data member in the struct, but I might also say, for example, if I have a property.
Well, those two are not related.
They're not strictly related. Like it's implementation dependent. So like for example, the device is actually on the, it is a data member. But I could have a volume, for example, that I said I don't want a data member for. If you send the volume, I'll directly just send the volume to the device. And when you want to read the volume, I'll directly read the volume from the device. So it doesn't have to be backed by a data. Usually you don't do that, for example, this volume thing that I was talking about, what we do is we actually keep a data member. And so that when you want to read it, it's cached. Right? So that you're not hitting transport every time you move query this thing.
It's also interesting because sometimes you can get properties which are backed to data members, but not directly. You can be part of a list. So I think implicit in the list. You can say that you have number of devices, which you get a in the list, the length of the list. And implicitly, right, it's just we're making the capital as well.
Right. So properties are handed. Right. So signals are again something that GObject provides to have methods, methods defined on this object. Right. There are two types of methods you can have. You can have your standard signals are emitted by the object. So for example, if you had a GTK button, right, it would have a clicked property, a clicked signal. So every time basically what GTK is going to do is it's going to trap a click or maybe an enter, and it will emit the click property. So when you're writing the UI, you attach a function to the click signal, right? And you'll get a callback every time that signal is emitted by the
object. Who defines the signals?
It's defined by the object. So again,
but
when
you write the object.
Huh?
But I write the object.
Yeah, you write the object. So you define the set of signals that this object will emit. Right?
Basically
so,
method names.
They're method names. They're basically public API where you will get notifications with this name.
Callable method names.
Yes. Well, there are two types. One is you have action signals, which means I can call these functions on this object. And you have the reverse, which is basically just normal signals, which is this object will emit this, will call back this method when something happens. It's effectively a callback, like a name, like callback with a particular signature.
So like if you have a server, a HTTP server, when a connection comes in, you register to incoming connection, the signal, and whenever the connection comes in, you get your callback is called. That's it.
But the signal will be defined by
the
connection
server.
By the server object.
Yeah.
And you just register to it.
So it's part of that object's API. Right? Yeah.
So you inherit from the TCP server class in that case?
No, you're a user of the class.
You're an application which is using the library. And so you register, you connect to a signal, and when a signal is emitted by that, you're called by that as well.
I think in Qt, they have better implementation. They call it as slots.
I think you don't slots. Because in slots, you can only access members of that object. You can't access anything else outside of that. But in this, you can access anything anywhere. You pass user data, you can pass your own objects which you can use inside the callback. But in Qt, you can only operate on that object which you get the stuff for.
So, yeah. It's a feature that especially makes sense in the UI context for, like, I mean, you have this in pretty much every UI framework, right? You have UI widgets, and they emit some sort of you want to attach to some events on those widgets.
So I mean, in general, you would like in Java, you would say like add listener and give it a function object, basically.
That's exactly what you're doing. Like, so what I do is I do a G signal connect. I give it, for example, the audio tags change signal name, and I say give me and call back this function.
That's not exactly a part of object-oriented system.
No, it's not. So the object-oriented system part ended with the type system effectively, right? So this is basically a bunch of convenient stuff that is provided for you to for whatever it is that you're doing. Right. So for example, the playbin is like a very top level GStreamer. Element, effectively say, here, take this URI and play it for me, right? And it can do, and it'll just play it for you using guessing as much as possible. So how you do that is you do a GObject new and create a playbin, right? And you set the URI property on it, and then you just call an API to set the state to playing and play, right? And then say you want to say you're building a music player. Right? You give it a URI and you want to know when audio tags are changed, because then in your UI you say this is the artist, this is the title. So what you do is you do a G signal connect to audio tags change and give it a callback. Right? And the callback will need to be in this format. So it'll get back the playbin, it will get a stream ID and a set of it'll actually give whatever data you have, and then you can query the tags because now you're notified that the tags have changed. Right? Similarly, if I wanted to right, so this is how I get the tag. So this is like public API on this object. Right? So I emit the signal on it, it will populate populate a tag list and give it back to me. Right? So this is like I'm performing an action on this object with using a signal.
But it should look
Do you guys want to see the code?
Just call connect and give
It's fairly standard, what you'd expect. Right. So yeah. So basically, when you're registering the signal, you specify the return, the return, the types of the return values and the types of the arguments, and possibly any marshallers, like custom marshallers that you want to give. So the idea, remember, all of this needs to be bindable to whatever language you're writing from, both the properties and the signals, right? So it's pretty well specified what kind of closures are expected, and so you'll be able to specify that whatever language it needs to be able to talk to that. And you can always provide a default implementation. Like typically what you do is you have your class has like a function pointer which you use where you put the default function, and you can always override it. Yeah. Right, so this is pretty much the last part. Geometric introspection was something that we added a few years ago to effectively look at the code and say and generate a sort of description that allows you to generate to create bindings. So you look at your all your objects. You can even have all the API on top of it. We have like documentation that's just embedded with the code, and now we added annotations to talk about the semantics of ownership. So if I'm passing a pointer around, who owns that pointer and things like that. And you saw properties, signals, all of that is fairly well defined in terms of types and stuff like that. So using all this, we actually build like an introspection mechanism, like basically a file that has a description of everything. And using that, we can actually automatically generate language bindings. So we used to have like manually written Python bindings for all the libraries that wanted to support Python. It's really painful to, you know, every time you add API, you make sure it's upgraded and stuff. So now
which wanted to
have Python support. Even write
libraries written in G object, which
C libraries that want to be able to be usable in Python.
Okay.
Needed to have manually generated bindings. So you might have some helpers.
Which you can still do, right? If you want to use say webkit through Python, you would have to.
Right, but you don't have like with GStreamer, which is actually a pretty hardcore user of G object. We managed to get rid of all the handwritten bindings altogether, and everything is now basically automatically generated. Like you have a binding generator, like you have a Python library that automatically reads geometric introspection data and creates Python classes and stuff.
What is it, like idiomatic?
See, he asking this question because he knows.
Yeah,
so you have overrides which kind of make it idiomatic, and if you have enough overrides, you can make it.
I mean, you can have like a low level generated code and then write the idiomatic library over it.
Yeah. That's what we method overrides do. That's what method overrides do.
Right.
Makes sense.
The hard part is like connecting the Python bits to.
Yeah, transforming Python objects to
the
object.
Yeah,
maybe,
exactly.
Which is what you're generating.
It actually reads the code which you write, reads the documentation in the code, figures out what everything is, actually runs the compiler binary as well to figure out.
It basically gets the class registration, like the classes that are registered. It basically, once they're registered, it can then say, okay, so these are all the classes, these are registered with these properties, these signals, and then it can generate all that data correspondingly. Right, the asterisk on bindings made easy is obviously stuff like what Arthur was talking about, it may not be idiomatic, and there are like problems with cross compiling and things like that, which aren't necessarily the easiest, but still make life better than it used to be. And that's about it. Questions?
Why should I use this?
If you
may have a choice.
If you're writing C code, and I mean, it helps a lot, right? Like if you have to write all of this stuff from scratch, like a bunch of the foundation libraries, if you're writing something non-traditional, you want types, you want like an object-oriented system, you have different, like something not very simple. This definitely is better than writing straight up C.
Is there an alternative?
This Qt, it's written in C++, but again, it provides sort of a bunch of stuff that you wouldn't get in straight up C++, like network code, IO code, whatever else.
In terms of like just object oriented C.
When you mentioned how OOP or very naturally applies to UI, right? I talk about EFL.
Yeah.
The Enlightenment,
there's a project also has a foundation library similar to this.
Which is
this person's code.
I have a bunch of widget UI code, right?
No, that so
this is separated out.
GNOME, GObject, GIO are just the base layers. Like GDK and GDK are the ones that provide.
This is separate.
Anything within the GDK environment you don't really have to trust.
Yeah, not really. So if you're using, if you're building anything GNOME or anything using GDK, you're or even GStreamer, you I mean the underlying layers are GObject, so you're going to be using GObject. Like everything is derived from a GObject. So you have to set a property, you have to do a GObject set and stuff like that.
So what I found is that if you're working on embedded and you can't use like Python because of your strings and you have to use C, GDK you should definitely use C, otherwise you're just kicking yourself in the foot. Because especially string manipulation, that part, like if you do it in C, you tear your heart attack out.
And like building strings and stuff like that in C is like...
And so like, for instance, it provides like, show, like just show stuff that GDK provides. With strings, arrays.
Oh yeah, there's a bunch of data structures that are also useful.
So. But that seems kind of extreme. Like, so GDEM seems to provide way more than just string manipulation.
No,
yeah,
like oh yeah. So the main thing it gives you is an event loop, right? So you can basically write main loops like you normally would in applications. Yeah, threads, thread pools, async queues, modules, memory management, I/O.
And we like I/O is
data structures.
Hmm?
You said data structures.
Oh yeah, this all kind of like queues, what else?
Hashtables. Single linked list, double linked list.
What about concurrent linked lists?
No. We have locking. So
you have async queues and stuff.
Oh, okay, yeah, that's
different. That's not the same. But anyway, so GLib is like sort of standard library for these things.
Yeah.
So
what
is this thing which gives you just the object oriented thing? GTAP instance and those things.
GObject. So GLib is like this big project and it has the libGLib which provides all the stuff, and then libGIO which provides the IO stuff, and then there's libGObject which is only the object stuff.
So you can use it separately?
Yes, you can use it separately.
Which we do in GStreamer because only GObject.
Yeah.
And it's possible.
And what kind of performance overhead?
So GObjects are obviously heavier than writing your own state of structures because you've got this type system. The type system is not that heavy, but once you start dealing with properties and signals, I mean, there is a bit of overhead because, like, you're kind of, if you need to marshal and unmarshal and things like that and do like type checks and stuff like that, that does get a bit heavier. So, on the flip side, your Nokia N900, which was a 800 megahertz, like OMAP 3 processor, was entirely based on this stuff. And this was 5 years ago. So and at that point, when like at that point, people did see, okay, wait, we're hitting problems with, for example, where things are heavy, where there are more locks than required, and things like that. And those were kind of fixed. So I mean, this has been used in like fairly low power embedded use cases. So as far as weight goes,
TV shippers,
huh?
TV shippers.
Yeah, TV shippers now. Well, with smartwatches, shippers now. So
in GStreamer, like GStreamer 0.1, everything was a GObject. And within that, because of particular framework, some things are done like millions of times.
Like if you're passing audio buffers at 10 milliseconds, you're creating and destroying 100 of them or more a second. Like, and at that point, it becomes not worth it to create and like create a new GObject 100 times a second. That becomes a performance problem.
And so
that happens in like Java also.
Right.
So for that, in the streamer, they made something called the GST mini object, which is for things
which is
a lot.
Yeah, which is a ref-counted. It's a ref-counted object, which is not a full-fledged G object. So it's like it's a ref-counted structure.
It's definitely GBox, I think.
Yeah. So there is infrastructure to have effectively a box type, which is a non-G object structure. You can just say this is a structure, and this is how I can box and unbox it.
Cool. Okay.
Alright.
What I really like is also that you can write cross-platform based code. So you can string library, you need to value whether it's Gthread or Windows Threads or whatever. You just use Gthread and take care of everything. Same with locking. It has Gmutex, it has a mutex implementation, we have the custom mutexes and stuff. They're all taken care of for you. Network, I always taken care of them. You can just use one single API. I don't worry about Windows having separate API for whether it's POSIX or it's on Android or whatever else. It will just work across everything else.
Did you just use the phrase recursive mutex?
Yes.
You mean multi-entering, like what is it called?
Yeah, like within the same thread you can...
What code does it look at to generate those Python bindings? Like, does it look at like the compiled code?
No, so effectively you generate this thing called GIR, which when you're compiling the code, will actually compile the stub, which causes all your objects to register themselves.
Okay.
And therefore the classes are registered, and therefore it can introspect the classes in from the type system.
Okay.
Okay, so it creates that. It creates all the metadata about the types during build time and generates a file.
But how would you do it like during build time? Like, won't the classes be created at runtime when you call the function?
No, so it builds a little stuff which instantiates all the types.
Oh, okay. So it like...
Yeah,
fine.
And runs that and then looks at the type system after instantiating all the types you want.
Oh, but like, how does GCC support this? Like,
GCC doesn't. There are tools. There are separate tools that do the
okay
pulling out this stuff.
It's Python.
So
Python.
Are there projects which are like higher level object oriented languages which compile directly to G object?
There's
yes.
Vala, which is a language for writing G objects. So you can it has a very C sharp type style. And when you create a class and objects in that, it compiles to C and
it's
G object. Yeah.
Voila.
Yeah.
I remember I didn't want
that. People still write about
it.
Wait, so it's not used anymore?
It's not actively developed anymore.
Yeah. I mean, it's like people are like, it's done.
Writing languages is hard. So.
It's kind of like nobody outside of. GNOME uses Vala, so people don't really ask for more features.
And at some point, JavaScript became the official language for
JavaScript.
Because obviously we can leverage all the JavaScript developers out there and stuff like that, which didn't work out very well as a
JavaScript.
It didn't. No, I mean, well, there are a lot of shell extensions, but none of the apps written in JavaScript are for GNOME now. But all that effort did make sure that our intersection, like before Python was the go-to language for if you wanted to write GeoBits but not C. And now it's become that the intersection part is at least good enough to generate multiple language bindings from the same base.
So which are the language bindings you think is?
Rust.
There's Rust.
You say it's JavaScript also?
There is JavaScript is the first class. It's in
JavaScript.
Like the shell, a lot of the this is written in JavaScript.
The entire shell is written in JavaScript. All the UI elements that you see are all in JavaScript. CSS in JavaScript. We have our own implementation of CSS.
You have your own what?
CSS
is
implementation.
CSS is implementation.
Libcro. It's a subset of CSS.
You guys want to break for snackages, etc., and then continue with the conversation?
Thank you.